A key center for the future of Starship launch cadence is SpaceX's test center at McGregor, Texas. SpaceX's ultimate goal is to enable humans to live on Mars. The company runs around-the-clock operations to develop the technology and Starship spacecraft that could make it possible. SpaceX founder Elon Musk hopes to have the first sustainable settlement on the Red Planet by the year 2050.
Chad, this is Elon Musk.
Who?
Elon Musk.
I'm in charge of the whole Mars colonization project.
The ambitious timeline pushes SpaceX teams to innovate rapidly. In this video, we are going to look at Elon Musk's long-term plan for the Starship Raptor production in Starbase, Texas. We are also going to look at James Webb passes critical mission review for 2021 launch, final testing nearing completion. The company is preparing to perform its first orbital flight test with a prototype of the Starship launch system, which includes the spacecraft atop, a gigantic super heavy rocket that will propel it to orbit. The company plans to launch Starship from South Texas to orbit, then land it off the coast of Hawaii, during the first orbital flight attempt. This past week, engineers initiated the booster's test campaign, which involves ground testing the stainless steel vehicle. Once in operation, the Starship Super Heavy Duo will become the world's more powerful rocket, capable of lifting over 100 tons of cargo, with powerful Methalox-fueled Raptor engines. Musk says the rocket could have 29 to 33 Raptor engines. Each Raptor is capable of producing over 200 tons of thrust. The spacecraft will be equipped with 6 Raptors, 3 sea-level engines, for atmospheric flight, and 3 Raptor vacuum RVac engines, for propulsion in space. These vacuum-optimized engines are much larger. Worth noting that thrust is only slightly higher, with the big bell nozzle version. Larger bell is primarily for efficiency in vacuum. Aiming for 380 plus second ISP for RVac long-term. Initially likely to be approximately 372, Musk previously said. Starship will be capable of transporting 100 passengers on long-duration voyages through space. It will feature private cabin rooms and common areas where the space adventurers will hang out in transit to the Moon, Mars, and beyond. On Saturday, Musk shared a photograph of Raptor engines lined up side by side inside a hangar that appears to be at Boca Chica Beach in South Texas, where Starship is under development. Fellowship of the Raptors, he captioned the photo. The sea-level engines are roughly 3 meters tall, with a 1.3 meter diameter. The vacuum Raptors have a much larger bell nozzle, exact measurements of RVac pending. Musk also shared some of SpaceX's Starship Raptor engine production plans that would enable humanity to colonize Mars over the course of the next 20 years. The company will set up a new engine manufacturing facility. We are breaking ground soon on a second Raptor factory at SpaceX Texas test site, he said via Twitter. The factory will be located in McGregor, Texas, where SpaceX currently manufactures and tests the Falcon 9 Merlin engines. This will focus on volume production of Raptor 2, while California factory will make Raptor vacuum and new, experimental designs, he said. By volume production, I mean 2 to 4 engines per day. That's super high volume for big rocket engines, but low volume by automotive standards, Musk added. Long term, he said that SpaceX targets to manufacture roughly 800 to 1,000 engines per year. That's about what's needed over 10 years to create the fleet to build a self-sustaining city on Mars. City itself probably takes roughly 20 years, so hopefully it is built by 2050, Musk said. McGregor typically completes multiple static fires every day, and already performs similar duration testing of Merlin vacuum engines and upper stages, so it's possible, if not probable, that one or several other 5 or 6 minute long tests have simply been missed over the last few months. With at least the first test flight of Super Heavy and Starship set to splashdown, as opposed to a return to a landing site, a large stock of Raptor engines will be required before the engines are expected to return with their vehicles for future flights. Super Heavy will now host 29 engines on its aft, as observed via a photo of a new thrust puck of Super Heavy, and then confirmed by Musk on Twitter. He added that Super Heavy would eventually evolve to hosting 33 engines. The supply line for this engine demand is being focused at the production site at SpaceX HQ in Hawthorne, California. Musk added that Raptor production is approaching one every 48 hours, most likely a reference to one Raptor rolling off the production line every 48 hours. Raptors are then shipped to SpaceX's test center at McGregor in Texas, where they are test-fired to validate the engines, ahead of being sent to the South Texas launch site. SpaceX currently utilizes two horizontal test bays, and one vertical, tripod, test stand, the latter converted from being a Falcon 9 test stand. McGregor has already supplied R-Boost engines up to RB5, with that engine seen arriving into Starbase, along with Raptor vacuum engine last week. The Raptor van is making almost daily trips on the Texas highways between the two sites, meaning the stock of Raptors already at Starbase could be in double digits. The joint NASA-ESA-CSA James Webb Space Telescope has passed its critical final mission analysis review, clearing the way for a late 2021 launch from the Guiana Space Center in Kourou, French Guiana on an Arianespace Ariane 5 rocket. With this review completed, Arianespace and JWST teams can now begin final launch preparations. With a launch readiness date of October 31, 2021, Webb will soon be transported to French Guiana, where it will be mated with its designated Ariane 5 rocket. The mission analysis review, carried out by Arianespace and ESA, confirms that all launch systems, such as the telescope, rocket, ground systems, and launch teams, are set for launch. The review also confirms that Webb itself and its flight plan are ready for the mission to begin. We are thrilled to have passed this important step towards the launch of Webb, and to have received the green light from Arianespace and NASA, says Peter Rumler. Rumler is the project manager for the JWST at ESA. When the telescope launches, it will experience a wide range of forces, such as vibrations and temperature changes and radiation. Therefore, Arianespace performed technical evaluations on important milestones of the mission's ascent for the review, such as the launch trajectory and separation of the telescope from the rocket's upper stage. Additionally, as part of the mission analysis review, ESA and other launch teams worked to compute the launch window needed to place JWST at the L2 Lagrange point. Calculating the launch window is highly complex due to the need to ensure that the Ariane 5 second stage continues to escape from the Earth while the telescope enters the L2 point safely. The telescope will continue on the transfer orbit trajectory for 4 weeks before entering orbit at L2. Once at L2, the telescope will undergo a six-month commissioning phase before entering full science operations. After the telescope has been commissioned and Webb is in full science operations, it will observe the universe in the near-infrared and mid-infrared wavelengths. Near-infrared and mid-infrared are wavelengths longer than visible light, allowing JWST to see more of the universe than visible light telescopes like the Hubble Space Telescope. Observing in the infrared is not easy, though. For Webb to observe in infrared, it will carry state-of-the-art instruments, such as specially designed cameras, spectrographs, and coronagraphs. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.